Welcome to this edition of Global Cruise Report. I'm Peter Greenberg. I'll be speaking to the world's leaders in the cruise industry, from CEOs to heads of operations, from the ports, design innovators, as well as updates on real-world conditions and what you can expect.
One of the organizations at the forefront of getting the cruise industry sailing again is the Global Sustainable Tourism Council. It establishes and manages standards for sustainable travel and tourism, with the aim of increasing sustainable tourism knowledge and practices among both public and private stakeholders. Recently, I spoke with Ioannis Pappas. He's the director of the Mediterranean region for the GSTC. There's a green revolutionist approach, and there's also an epidemiological approach now. And then last but not least, there's a physical infrastructure approach. And all these things have to be done, not in isolation, but together. In terms of the ports themselves, how did you have to physically change the ports in terms of structure, technology, procedures?
Most of the cases that you can see here also in Greece are not really focused on leisure. So they are trying to find their balance. And then try to find also people that would like to run this scenario, because many of the ports, not only in Greece, but generally speaking, they're trying to make also very big steps on the change of ownership, the change of operations, management, model. So it is, not a complicated scenario, but it is an equation that in every case, it's a different one.
But you're also talking about a quantum change in philosophy.
How, port together with cruise and together with all the facilities and all the people and all the companies on the local level, the travel agents and all the others, can work together in order to achieve something for the destination. That's the idea, that's the target. And how sustainable this could be, and how this can, react on a broader, level for a region or even for the country. That's the idea.
You know, I use as an example, this goes back, I think, almost 25 years in the state of Alaska, which, as you know, in the summer months, in their high cruise season between May and September, you could have as many as 39 ships in the Inside Passage. And one of the local communities in Alaska finally said, you know what, it's not about charging a head tax. It's not about charging a cruise ship per passenger, because they're just going to pass those costs on to the passengers. What we're going to do is something else. And so they erected certain power stations and power ports in these ports so that when a cruise ship lands, they literally have a large extension cord, if you will, and they plug into the local power grid, as opposed to operating the cruise ship generators and engines, which from a carbon footprint perspective was really not a good idea. Are you considering doing that as well in Greece?
You know, this is a big challenge for a system of electricity system, for isolated, islands, not taking account Corfu or Crete, but there are cases that it's not very easy, because as you can imagine, if you're going to put a very big ship in a port that is not a very big island, this is not very easy to handle. But especially for Greece, and given that a very big program of connecting with cables almost all the islands of Aegean, Sea, and also an Ionian part, so they can be connected in the near future, this could happen, and this will be one part of the solution. We have seen the same situation not only in cases like Greece with Ireland, but also in Dubrovnik. Dubrovnik, they have a very big, plan in order to see in the future how they can connect that and how they can achieve that, because part of the solution that we're discussing was that. But at the same time, it is not a very easy issue even for the land. They have to do all this kind of special, studies to make the infrastructure, to find, the money, the funding. So, yeah, this is the future.
From giving me an example point of view, of which port in Greece have you had the most success with in getting them to move quickly to embrace all these ideas in much the same way that Dubrovnik is doing it?
These two ports are the port of Corfu in the Ionian Island, in the Ionian Sea, nearby Dubrovnik, and the other port is the port of Heraklion in Crete.
And why those two ports? Why did you pick those two?
Actually, there was, like I said, an evaluation matrix that we have created based on the multi-criteria analysis in order to see with different approaches and actually principles who will be, let's say, the most challenging or the most appropriate for this step. So there is a ranking methodology. So these two ports are the first two on the top.
Are you saying they're the first two because they're the most challenged?
They are not actually only the most challenged, but the most, willing and ready and, let's say, multipliers for the future of all these big lists. That's the idea. And there are more. There are something like around 20 ports around Greece. So we hope that after this starting point, because this is the starting point of such a very interesting initiative, for at least for Greece, but I think also for CLIA and for GSTC, they're going to be more in order to go that direction. So we're trying, to make, a vaccine to the port management about sustainability and not just making, some environmental friendly actions, but to see their role inside the destination development.
The clock is ticking. Cruising is going to resume. It already has resumed in many ports in Europe, but on a much larger scale by this summer. Everything else, considered, fingers crossed, it will be back. So these ports are going to be doing these changes as this cruising numbers are increasing at the same time.
Of course, also Heraklion was, the hub port for restarting cruising after the pandemic, of the first wave at least. So it was very important for us to see all this as a success and a starting point together with CLIA that support very much all this situation. So for us, at least for Greece, and I think for many ministries, not only for the Ministry of Tourism, but also for the Ministry about, the shipping and ports and everything, and actually the central government, is very important because we're going to see and evaluate what is really the readiness, more or less, of the Greek ports for the next period. Going and coming from the sustainability point of view, but it's very important because our criteria, our destination standard is so, robust and so complete, that it's going to be very important for them, and they are going to feel it. They're going to use it as a very important tool within.
Dubrovnik is another case study, a picture-perfect medieval city in Croatia, one of the most popular destinations in the Mediterranean. Why? Well, for starters, Game of Thrones was filmed there. And every cruise ship in the world started calling on Dubrovnik. Too many, in fact. It became almost too popular. Then the mayor stepped in and worked with the cruise industry to spread out the scheduling, to limit the number of cruise ships that could be in Dubrovnik at any one time. Deputy Mayor Jelka Telpsic talks to me about their plans then, before the pandemic, and what they're doing going forward.
So Jelka, you and I have known each other for a long time. When we talk about sustainable travel, when we talk about all the things that are being done now in the light of the pandemic, you guys were actually doing this a lot before the pandemic. You were working with the cruise lines to figure out the best way to manage your port and to make it sustainable, if you will, not just for cruise ship passengers, but for Dubrovnik itself.
The specific problem was too many cruise ships at the same time in our port, meaning that we used to have like five or six very big cruise ships. And, the sizes of cruise ships are getting higher and higher. So basically we had up to 10 to 12,000 passenger visitors in our city, which is very narrow, a tiny little city at the most southern part of Croatia. And it was not acceptable because our residents started to feel not comfortable. But then the situation was improved, and by our cooperation with CLIA, we managed to put some rules and regulations regarding the cruise ship calls.
What were the actual rules?
Actual rule and still functioning, and we hope that will remain that way for a long time in advance. So it's 4,000 cruise passengers per one part of the day, meaning if we are having 4,000 people in the morning, then we can allow another 4,000 in the afternoon, meaning then when two ships are leaving, two others are coming to the port. So it's basically, it's a management. It's only the way of how you are managing the calls, how you are managing the flow of tourists, embarkation hours, excursions hours. So it's a quite complex, let's say, work, but every year we are improving it.
And then came the pandemic. And yeah. So now you and so many other destinations around the world have been given, not because you planned on it, but an opportunity to do a reset, to be able to take a much broader view of your numbers, on your calendar, on your schedules, to see how you can learn from this and to manage it in the long term, haven't you?
First of all, we signed the Memorandum of Understanding with CLIA, and it was the starting point of our, let's say, future cooperation. But we are always stressing that CLIA is very, extremely valuable for us, because through CLIA, through the association, we were able to get in direct contact with the major cruise lines and with executive people there. And it was really very, very important for us, because they realized that we need their help. On the other hand, the Memorandum of Understanding appointed few programs, let's say, we are developing together. One of them, and maybe the most important one, is Global Sustainable Tourism Assessment, which was provided by CLIA and offered as sponsored by CLIA for the city of Dubrovnik. We did it, we performed it last November, let's say November 2019, and we got our report due to the COVID situation in May of 220, and Dubrovnik got a 70% score of sustainability, which is actually very good.
What are the metrics? What are they looking at specifically?
Specifically, it's based on 17 criteria, but by UNWTO regarding sustainability. So starting from destination management to cultural sites preservation, restoration, to ecological part of everyday's life, like recycling, like noise pollution, like sea water pollution, like using modern technologies, eco-friendly technologies, green technology, etc. It's quite complicated.
How did that translate to the cruise lines?
Well, basically, when the assessment deal with the traffic, then we presented our program, such as, for example, the web booking for buses at our pillar gate. That's directly connected with cruise ship passengers, because in order to come to the Old City, they should have a pre-booked time to be able to stop at Pillar Gate to the main entrance and let the passengers go in.
You had your port management issues prior to the pandemic. Now yes. We're in the brave new world of the pandemic. What have you had to do from a physical perspective in terms of infrastructure to change the makeup of the port so that there's proper testing, possibly an area to sequester someone who might test positive, without interfering with the rest of the crew or the passengers?
Yeah.
And of course, you know, everything is connected, right? Someone flies into Dubrovnik and may take a cruise. Someone comes into a cruise and may gets on a bus to take a tour. How have you figured out the new rules?
Each company has their own protocol. They're testing people before embarkation, during the cruise, and regarding excursions, they are not allowed to wander around on their own. They are only allowed to go on organized excursions and visits.
How have you figured out the footprint of Dubrovnik to allow for social distancing when the ships return?
We still do have two cruise ships per morning, if that means that they are not going to be 4,000 people. So we believe less people will give us a chance to maintain and keep the rules about social distances, wearing masks, etc. And those bubbles, if we are speaking about cruise companies and bubbles, then it's a lot easier because all those groups are organized. There are people in contact with each other every day, and they are not going around. As I told you, they are not allowed to go around by themselves. So they will be moving around in organized groups. That makes for us also the situation easier. And I have to stress that regarding COVID situation, and you, I think you saw it, we do have big banners with signs, so please keep your distance. And also we made a short video, animated video, based on the fact that Dubrovnik was one of the first back then states in the world to have organized quarantine. In 1337, we already had the rules for quarantine. And in 16th century, we did have a first, actually building quarantine.
I went there. Yes. And in those days, it wasn't 14 days, it was 40.
40, that's very true.
So. Exactly.
I'm Peter Greenberg. I'll see you next time on another edition of Global Cruise Report.